prepare ourselves. I've got 10 more minutes to be with you when you start. God bless you. It's a blessing to be back here.
Thank you.
fixing what we can have confidence. So much confidence in Him. Amen. Thank God for all of you all who are here today in the house and those who are at home watching. We thank God for what He's already done and for what He's about to do. As usual, we're going to begin with the word from the Lord and then we'll have our prayer.
We're going to all stand for the reverence of the Lord. And I'll be reading Matthew 26, 41, KJV. And it says, "Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening, Lord, and we just thank you, Lord. We bless your holy name, and we give you glory, God, for all that you have done and are doing in our lives, Heavenly Father. Thank you for keeping us, Heavenly Father. Thank you for giving us confidence, oh God, what the song said in you, Lord, and not in ourselves, Heavenly Father. God, I thank you for what you're doing on tonight, Heavenly Father, Lord. Increase our understanding, God. Increase our wisdom in you, Heavenly Father, that will give you glory, Lord. And I pray for Pastor Tim on tonight, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would work through him in a mighty way, Heavenly Father, to give your people what they need, Heavenly Father. Lord, I pray that you would give him a word that he needs to make it through the week, God. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, have your way, Heavenly Father. We give you glory even now. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Tonight, we have a very special moment tonight. God, I thank you for your prayers. But I pray that God will shift that from me to our special guest speaker tonight. He's one of our very own. He has been blessed to be a major blessing and a help to me. He said things that have ministered to my own life. While he claims he's getting advice from me, he's really been a blessing to me. And I thank God for him. I think you'll be blessed by what he has to share and his teaching. He is a teacher by profession for the time being. That gifting will never leave. And so he's on his way to full entrepreneurship and other open doors as God designs for him. So y'all, come on, let's put your hands together for tonight's teacher, my good brother and my friend, like a son to me, Brother Warren Seal.
Tells him in that scripture, "Hey, you have too many people. You being Midianites would be too easy at this point." Mm-hmm. sometimes it makes so much sense that we get something done by our own hand. That's not how God works all the time. Continue, please. Now, therefore, go to, proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whosoever is fearful and afraid, let him return and depart early from Mount Gilead. And there returned the people 22,000, and there remained 10,000. And the Lord said unto Gideon, the people are yet too many. Bring them down unto the water, and I will try them for thee there. And it shall be, that of whom I say unto thee, this shall go with thee, the same shall go with thee, and whomsoever I say unto thee, this shall not go with thee, the same shall not go. So, God tells me, so we have Gideon there with 22,000 people. It's 22,000 guys. And he's like, yep, still too many. He sent 12,000 dudes on. And he said, you have 10,000 left. Goes a little further. I'm just thinking about what I would be, how I would be if I was Gideon, if I was told, hey, you're supposed to go into war with all these guys. You have so many people with you. And then God cuts that number down. And I'm thinking, oh, I know you said you're going to give me the victory, but, oh, this is getting a little funky now. And so you're rocking with 10,000 now. And you go a step further, and he says, you still have too many guys.
Do you think he's doing that to make Gideon have to rely on him alone?
So that answer is actually in verse 2. Lest the Israelites vaunt themselves against me, saying, my own hand hath saved me. So he's saying that you have so many people, and it's obvious that you would win this war against the Midianites. But I don't want you to think it was by your own power that you did so. So I'm going to cut you down until it looks like you have no way of winning it. And then you say it could have been nobody else but God.
Yeah.
Did you continue? What verse were you in? Verse 5.
So he brought down the people onto the water. And the Lord said unto Gideon, everyone that lappeth of the water with his tongue, as a dog lappeth, him shalt thou set by himself. Likewise, everyone that boweth down upon his knees to drink. And the number of them that lapped, putting their hand to their mouth, were 300 men. But all the rest of the people bowed down upon their knees to drink water. And the Lord said unto Gideon, by the 300 men that lap will I save you, and deliver the Midianites into thine hand, and let all the other people go, every man unto his place.
Up there. So you started with 22,000. You know you're going to get the victory. It makes sense. You cut down to 10,000. Like I said, if I'm Gideon, I'm a little worried. Like, okay, what's going on now? And God says, after he cut them down a little bit, he cut the army down, he said, you still have too many guys. Imagine going from 10,000 guys fighting with you to 300. You can fit all those guys in one room. And you're supposed to be fighting Midianites whose camels are innumerable. I mean, they have warriors. It's a vast army you're fighting against with 300 guys. Nobody but God. Verse 7. I don't know what verse 8.
So the people took victuals in their hand and their trumpets, and he sent all the rest of Israel, every man unto his tent, and retained those 300 men. And the host of Midian was beneath him in the valley. And it came to pass the same night that the Lord said unto him, arise, get thee down unto the host, for I have delivered it into thine hand. But if thou fear to go down, go thou with Pharaoh, thy servant, down to the host, and thou shalt hear what they say, and afterward shall thy hands be strengthened to go down to the host. Then went he down with Pharaoh, his servant, unto the outside of the armed men that were in the host.
So the Lord tells him, after I've cut your army down from so vast to 300 guys, you're still going to get the victory. So I want you to go down to the Midianite host. That means the camp. That's where everybody is. That's where all the warriors are at this point.
all armed. And he says, but if you're scared to go, you can take food out with you. If I'm Gideon, I'm taking somebody with me at this point. I'm saying, we start off with 22,
right.
Now we at 300, I'm taking somebody with me. And all the while, when all the odds seemed like they were stacked against Israel, or Gideon, from Gideon's perspective, God still says, oh, y'all been delivered already? Okay, all right. How? Continue.
And the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the children of the east lay along in the valley like grasshoppers for multitude, and their camels were without number as the sand by the seaside for multitude. And when Gideon was come, behold, there was a man that told a dream unto his fellow, and said, behold, I dreamed a dream, and lo, a cake of barley bread tumbled into the host of Midian, and came unto a tent, and smote it that it fell, and overturned it, that the tent lay alone. And his fellow answered and said, this is nothing else save the work of save the sword of Gideon, the son of Jehosh, a man of Israel, for into his hand hath God delivered Midian and all those.
Hold it right there. So now Gideon is directed to go down to the camp where all the guys are. Mind you, didn't say anything about him having a sword, no arms, no nothing. All he went down there with one guy. That's all he had. And he's being told constantly, hey, I delivered you already. That's what the Lord is telling him. He's sneaking down to this camp. He goes down there with Phurah, and he hears the guards that are still awake say, oh man, that had to be that dream you had. No, I think they, you know, they about to get us. They about to get us at this point. In 15.
What do you think the rolling bread?
Okay. Well, do my words study. The cake was a level of consumption, like filling yourself up with something.
Right.
And then the barley was a very, what's the word? It's like the cheapest of the grains, right? When I went into a deeper word study with that, it turned to feed. So the cake of barley represented the Midianites being consumed by fear.
Also, I believe the thing to consider the idea that everything in the Old Testament points to the New Testament. And so whenever you look at bread, it normally speaks to the bread of life. But it goes. So when Jesus to come, and which comes from Bethlehem, in the New Testament, when it shows a large loaf of bread rolling down, it is to say that the word of God would never be in one place, but ever moving. And when it gets to your enemies, it will consume and destroy your enemies. And so when it came to the Midianites, he was saying that even though all Gideon had was themselves and their sword, it is my word that would destroy the people. And so for us, it makes us understand that we need to start living on the power of the word and not the power of ourselves. If we trust the word, his word is ever moving. And no matter how shifty our enemies may be, his word is moving faster. And if they change, they scheme on us 10 times over again. It does not matter. His word will always catch it. And every time they shift, he'll catch it again. And his word will roll over and kill all our enemies. Good stuff.
So is he saying that he's not, and another way of him saying that his word is the sword?
Yes, absolutely.
Because it's faster than any blade that you can actually cut with.
And it cuts coming and going. The double-edged sword. Double-edged sword.
And that's what represents the armor.
Yes, yes. And if we look at it that way, then we see what God was doing with Gideon. Because he said earlier that he's making sure that God, he won't share his glory. He'll get the credit for what's about to happen. So the same way God did it in the Old Testament, he manifests himself again in the New Testament. And he said, this is the way I fought in the old. is telling you how to fight in the new.
That's good. Yes, ma'am.
So my question is that with Gideon still doubting God, like, you know, still questioning if God was still delivering, because when he told him to go, then later on he was like, well, if you're feared, go down there with the other God and stuff, and then I guess God ended up having some piece of confidence, like, hey, by the man told him a dream. Now I'm pretty sure Gideon was like, okay, well, right. Now you know. I can do it. But, you know, to me it seemed like he was still doubting God even after he did the whole being pleased and stuff. And you hear he's still doubting God. It seems to me.
I believe that Gideon's issue was that he was put in a very uncomfortable situation. It wasn't that he didn't think that God would deliver him in Israel. It was that everything he saw to be a good sign, like, oh, we got this. God was like, mm-mm. That's mine. Oh, I think we can do it. And so Gideon's sense of comfort was taken away. And when your sense of comfort is taken away and you're still told to go do something, you second guess. Well, I don't know if I should. I mean, I know what you said, but I only got $20 in my pocket. And so I think Gideon's sense of comfort was taken away, which caused him to steady say, God, is this really what you want?
Yeah. And it betrayed his position. Because he's talking about a man of war who knows how to fight, who knows strategy, who knows how things work. And you're going to tell me that everything I've learned all my life, I have to betray to obey you? And I think that's the problem we have today.
Yes.
That we have learned what works for us. And then God has the nerve to come along and tell us, forget all of that and go do this.
Right.
And we be like, oh, I want to obey you, but I want to, but I know what that looks like. I don't know what this looks like.
Right.
And that don't make no sense. And I ain't trying to be smart with you, God.
Yes.
But this don't make no sense right here.
Right. I'm just saying.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. We're 15 now?
Will you expand on the lapping moment?
Oh, with the drinks.
We talked about that.
Yeah, let's go back.
That was awesome. Was it 8
of people? Oh, yeah, that was 8. If there was,
I'll read it again. I want you to expound on it again, because when we were talking about it, you gave me some good information. It says, so he brought down the people unto the water, and the Lord said unto Gideon, everyone that lappeth of the water with his tongue as a dog lappeth, him shalt thou set by himself. Likewise, everyone that boweth down upon his knees to drink, and the number of them that lapped, putting their hand to their mouth, were 300 men. But all the rest of the people bowed down on their knees to drink water. Will you elaborate on why God chose the ones that lapped like dogs over the ones that knelt down to drink water like regular people? Y'all, he did it already. I want him to just say it out loud.
So with the guys who hit their knees to drink the water, they were, what's the word? I'll just explain it this way. Had there been an ambush, none of them would have been ready.
Period.
Not one. Because they were not prepared. They were unprepared for the moment. While the other guys, the other 300, they drank the water wisely, making sure whenever they drank, they were still ready in case it was time to go. In case it was time to fight. whatever the case was, they were always ready, right? Because those men were still on their feet. But you got the guys that's on their knees, they had next to the process.
Does everybody know what that looks like, what the difference between the two was? Good to see you, man. So, I mean, I've been with you all time to see it, ain't trying to be crazy. I want y'all to see what it looks like when you are down on your knees and you bend down to drink. There is no way you can defend yourself like that. But those who, I'm getting old. But when you scoop down and grab the water and do it this way, you're still watching it on your feet. Here's the issue. God is setting precedent for the New Testament. He says, not only should you pray, but you should, who said it? Watch and pray. And God is saying, some of y'all are praying, but some of y'all ain't even watching. And it's fine for you to pray, but you need to be watching and praying. And while you're praying, God said, I want you. I thank God for you. I appreciate you. But you ain't my fighter. The ones who are praying and watching, now them the folks ready to fight. Because they say, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to let God use my hands to defend myself. I need you praying and watching. Yes, ma'am.
Is there any symbolism, like, because you can drink more water, right, if you're bent down, like, kind of where, rather than if you're just cupping it with your hands and going like this. So is there any, like, correlation or symbolism with that?
Absolutely. Patience.
Patience. Okay.
Patience, absolutely. Because those who are prepared to fight know how to exercise patience. Those who are not prepared to fight want to get as much as they can as fast as they can. And they're willing to risk their vulnerability and the protection of their household in order to get more. And God says, a true fighter, one who leans and depends on me, understands the importance of getting a little at a time until you're fully nourished in order to protect what I've told you to protect. Some of us ain't protecting God's gift in us. God has put so much in us. And we'll jump on every opportunity. Everybody call you to do something, you run to go do it. You won't even pray about it first. Everybody asks you to do this, you run to go do it. Because you want to be in the spotlight. You want somebody to look at you and see what you look like. And see, I want you to see the gift that God gave me, because it's so wonderful. And you're going into the devil's den and ain't even ready for it. And then you wonder why you leave damaged and broken. And God is saying, you need to be watching and praying. Talk to me, and you need to be watching the people. Some of the people that are calling you to do stuff, they showed you years ago that they don't care nothing about you, and they wish you'd be destroyed. But now they see you got a little bit of a gift. They want to jump in and ask you, girl, you know I've been loving you all the time. I just love your gift. If you come over here from my banquet and do so and so and so and so, you pray so well, girl. You pray so well. And they have no intent on caring about your relationship with Christ. And God said you need to be watching and praying, and you've got to be patient sometimes before you move. And if you take it a little bit at a time, if that keeps the hand of God protected over you, then protect your relationship with Christ. Yes, sir.
As a believer and as a warrior of Christ, what does it look like to watch, to be watching?
Say it again.
As a believer and as a warrior, what does it look like to be ready, stay ready, watch, trying to get ready, to be watchful and praying? What does that look like as a believer?
Ooh, man.
And you're good at that.
I believe it's being mindful to be used. Always ready to be used. So when you're being watchful, it's not stepping out of alignment.
That's good.
Not doing anything against God's character. That's good. Or putting yourself in a situation to do anything against God's character. And to know yourself. Know yourself. If you go to the casino and you got a gambling problem, probably not being the most watchful. You put yourself in a position to do something that you know you shouldn't be doing, you know what I mean? But When you recognize the things that God is changing in you, you have to be mindful not to put yourself back in those old ways. But to succumb to your old you. Anything you want to add?
Yes, sir, absolutely. I think you answered it already. But just kind of go dig a little deeper in that same moment to watch as well as pray means that I talk to the Lord, but while I'm talking to the Lord, I'm watching for his hand.
Yes.
I'm looking for his movement. Because a lot of times we pray and we just drop it.
Yeah.
And God is saying, no, 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 no. This is not a monologue, it's a conversation.
Right.
So when you talk to me, expect me to talk back to you.
Right.
So that means the definition of the word watch in that scripture means to stay awake. Mm-hmm. It's what these people now call being woke.
Yeah.
But it's the real definition of being woke. Which means that sometimes, even though I love to shout and I love to dance, sometimes I just got my eyes open. Sometimes I ain't dancing. Sometimes when y'all are praying, I'm praying, but I'm looking. And I'm not just looking for the physical, I'm looking for the spiritual eye. Trying to see what's happening. Because a lot of times God gives us stuff just by keeping our eyes open and looking for his hand. Sometimes God will give us ammunition for our prayers. And that means I've got to stay connected. When Pastor preached, he said staying connected to the Lord, staying listening for his voice. And so now, not only do I talk to him, I'm looking for him to talk back to me. And so staying watching is staying awake, watching for the hand of God. And at all times. That means if you're not between these four walls, that's even more important of a time you're watching. And looking for God's hand. And that's when you walk it. And y'all, sometimes it's deeper than just in individual situations. Sometimes it's just driving down the street, looking for the hand of God. Watching the wind blow. Sometimes you can have read a scripture 3 weeks ago, and because you're watching, while you're riding down the road, see the wind shift a certain way, and it answers your question that you had 3 weeks ago. Also, it is being aware of the word of God. In other words, God says that the end is coming and we will know the season. If we don't know what God says in the word and his description of the season, we have no idea what to watch for. So we as believers have to be watching for what God told us is about to come. Y'all do realize that this is actually a book of prophecy. Prophecy speaks into tomorrow. In other words, if you don't know the prophecy, you have no idea when it has been fulfilled. So you have to be watching for what God said would come. Oh, I see. God told me about that. God said that the day would come where mothers would be against daughters, where fathers would be against sons. Oh, wow, the end is coming. So be watching, but you got to have the information to know what you're watching for. Amen. Did that answer your question?
Does sometimes the enemy knows what you're watching for, so he'll do something that mimics it? Like you said, the book is prophecy, so like the Antichrist will be mimicking the coming of Christ, or just little things like that. Are you looking for a sign, so the enemy will do a sign that's pretty similar? And how can you tell the difference between if it's the enemy or if it's God's hand?
We got people in the room before I answer. So I was getting pretty talk patient.
Discernment. Mm-hmm. Being plugged in to the Holy Spirit and recognizing the character of God. There are a lot of things that look like what they are, but discernment will tell you what. You'll be able to tell the wolf in sheep's clothing.
I think also like knowing your word. Because if you don't know your word and it lines up with the word, you're going to get confused. Or you're going to get deceived. So like knowing what the word says would help. And understanding what it says.
Yes, sir. I was also going to say that the devil doesn't know anything that you don't give him. So if you're trying to be able to give, if you're trying to be able to find an answer, or see a sign, if it ends up looking in a certain, it comes back down to discernment. But the devil only knows what you give him. He doesn't have more power than you allow him to have. So when you're trying to search for an answer, it's really just consulting the Lord and then being discerning of whether it's actually from God and getting the three forms of confirmation. Is it aligned with his character, his word, and his way? Or if it is not in alignment, and then you know already. If it's not one of the three, then it's none of the three.
Mm-hmm.
When you really spend time with God and really get into a zone to where you really know who he is, you can tell when he's speaking to you because of how close you are to him. The more time that you spend with God, the more you can understand when he's talking to you and when he's not talking to you. And I know that for me, when it's times that I'm just really close with God, like the prayer is strong, like the word is strong, I can immediately see the devil. I can see it coming before it even starts and be like, oh, let me move around from this situation because I already see what you're trying to do with it. So it's just like knowing anybody else. When you want to get to know somebody, you spend time with them. Mm-hmm. Then you're able to understand who they really are.
Discern, and then you have to test the spirit.
By the spirit,
yes. And then also, God is not the author of confusion. So anything that's fuzzy and confusing and, oh, I don't know, that's not from God.
Also, the teacher is spot on when he says use discernment. Mm-hmm. Because scripture says that the enemy will come like the light.
Yeah.
In other words, he's going to mimic the light of the world. And so the time is going to come where he's going to operate and he's going to look like what we think Jesus should look like. Mm-hmm. In fact, he's going to come and bring peace mm-hmm. to the earth. Isn't that crazy? But if we know the word, we know the next time Jesus comes back, he ain't bringing peace. But because we associate peace with God, with Jesus, the assumption will be, oh, wow, he must be of the Lord. So you're totally right. If there's going to be a moment where you can't, how do I know the difference between the two? And it comes back to discernment. Because And that was so on point of what preacher said, because at the end of the day, it may look like the word, but it may not agree with the character of God.
Yes.
And so you're like, okay, yeah, that looks like peace, but man, something is wrong with the character. Something don't feel right in the spirit. Something is battling with my spirit. Like, I know you embracing me and you're offering me stuff, but something don't feel right about what you're offering me. I feel like there's a nasty intent behind what you're giving me. And so you've got to have discernment. Scripture says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. So what we see should never be the definitive notion of what we believe. We should never be in a place where I am fully taken by what I saw. Something in my spirit has to say, this is actually the truth. We are getting to discernment.
I don't know what scripture at this point. Give it again.
15?
And it was so, when Gideon heard the telling of the dream and the interpretation thereof, that he worshipped, and went but and returned into the host of Israel and said, arise, for the Lord hath delivered into your hand the host of Midian. And he divided the 300 men into three companies, and he put a trumpet in every man's hand, with empty pitchers and lamps within the pitchers.
Oh, right there?
What number is
he on? He just finished 16. So we see Gideon this whole time is on the fence. Like, okay, God, I know you said you're going to give us victory. And I'm, you know, every time you tell me that, you take some away. What's up now? He goes down and hears the guards of the Midianite camp say, they about to come and get him. Goes back then, and you see where his mind shifted. right? He went from saying, are you sure? Is this the right thing to do? I'm not positive, to, oh, they think that they're about to get the living under our hand. Come on, y'all, let's go. It's go time. So it was just interesting to see how Gideon's mentality shifted, and also how God aligned it to where those guys, it took the Midianites, essentially, for Gideon to be like, oh yeah, okay, I got it now. I believe in that.
He worshiped.
Yeah, because when your enemy knows that you're about to beat them, oh, you have a different peace. You have a different level of security in knowing that, oh, step, even they know that my God is going to bring them down. I can't have no doubts in my God if those who don't even serve my God believe that my God is about to make something happen.
Yeah.
So I just got to rock with it at this point.
Hallelujah. It also talks about there's always time to worship.
Yeah.
Because it was time to fight. And he said, no, we ain't going to fight yet. Let me worship. And that's why I say we can't rush worship. That's good stuff.
Gideon divided the three kings. At first, he was talking about, oh, I don't have that many gods. But now it's time to go to war, and I know I got God. I know we good. Let me go on and take that 300, and let me split them in three companies. Like you said, let's split them up now. And as a warrior, as somebody who's a soldier, that don't make no sense. I mean, we fighting against thousands on thousands on thousands of guys with 300. But now, let's, right, no strategy whatsoever. But now let's take that 300 we have, that small number, to their big number, and let's split it up even more. Make it even smaller.
It's like a wedge that's pushing through the crowd.
And also teaches us to use what we got. Because sometimes we see everybody operating off of an enormous reserve. And we think that we can't accomplish what they've accomplished because they have more. And we don't realize, as long as we have God, we always have more. And greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. So the world needs those resources. We have the source. So we got everything we need to accomplish what God told us he said we could do and will do. Use what you got.
Use what you got. And I mean, and we're still talking about the soldier. God, you want me to go to war with just 300 guys and no weapons? I mean, when you break it all down, what Gideon is being asked to do at this point, it makes no sense whatsoever. No sense whatsoever. But it is cool to see that Gideon now is submitted to what's about to take place.
That they're using trumpets and lamps. Scripture has that Jesus will sound the trumpets and call us. And also through Scripture has the lanterns as it is the lighting of our way, the light unto our path.
Yeah.
So even while they were going through the valley in the shadow of death, which is war, they thought that they feared no evil. Like, was it going to be filled with blood?
So there is a symbolic nature to having an empty pitcher. I told you, everything in the Old Testament points to new. And God talks about us becoming an empty vessel that God will fill. That, listen to me, when you give your life to Christ, you are ineffective until you render yourself empty. Because if you come to God with too much, he has to empty you, to break you, in order to use you. And then we get upset with God because we go through so much. But God was saying, you were too full. And until you get empty, I can't feel you.
Yes.
And when I feel you, it'll be an overflowing cup
yes.
that people around you will eat off of. And you will never run dry. You will never be empty. But if you already got stuff in you that don't belong in you, what's in you will poison what God wants to put in you.
Yes.
So I need to break you, empty you, make you a new vessel, an empty vessel that God can now fill.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
So why did they put lamps in the empty vessels?
Man, your brother didn't answer that already. It's the light.
It's the light.
That's
because we will be.
Come on.
It's the light.
That's in us.
It's the light.
Yes, indeed.
You said that we're the salt of the earth and the light of the earth.
Yes,
it makes sense.
Yes,
it's
indeed.
The
fire
out of the cup.
Mm.
The light gotta come out.
Woo.
Illuminated
the light. Yeah. Most pictures are made from bronze. I didn't want to get far in this, but most pictures are made from bronze. If you remember in the tabernacle, when the priests would come in and they would actually kill the sacrifice, and when they killed the sacrifice, their hands would be filled with blood. They would go to the brazen altar, past the brazen altar, to the place where they would wash their hands. And when they would bend down, it would be made from bronze. Before they washed their hands, there would be fresh water in it. So when they looked down, they would see their reflection through the water in the bronze. But they were still a dirty vessel. But when they had the blood on their hands, they would wash their hands in the place, and the bronze place would still reflect their reflection, but they would see themselves through the mud.
Mm.
And so what God was saying with the light and the actual picture is that the light will be inside the bronze, and when we go through war, blood will be shed, but the light will still shine through the blood.
Okay.
The blood, now the light is inside of you. And though blood will be shed, God will say blood is a good thing, because now you have the blood of Jesus. And so now I see your light covered in his blood. And now your light is brighter than it ever would have been.
I'm telling you.
The world is good stuff, man.
I got excited, man. And he said unto them, look on me and do likewise. And behold, when I come to the outside of the camp, it shall be that as I do, so shall ye do. When I blow with the trumpet, I and all that are with me, then ye blow the trumpets also on every side of all of the camp, and say, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. So Gideon and the 100 men that were with him.
So wait, come on, I'm going to go too far. Read 18 one more time, please.
When I blow with the trumpet, I and all that are with me, then blow ye the trumpets also on every side of all the camp, and say, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon.
What's the sword of the Lord?
Word.
Okay, excellent. So we're on the same page. So when you hear the trumpets, right? Trumpet is a sound of victory. So all he does is goes down there. And like I said, he had already been to war before. No weapon. And says, hey, you know what? I'm just going to blow a trumpet. After you hear mine, y'all blow it too. Just do as I do. He blows his trumpet proclaiming victory before the war even started. And then everybody else does the same. And when he says the sword of the Lord, he's saying the word of God is about to come upon y'all. And then of Gideon. So Gideon, we know from the last chapter, from chapter 6, he got the nickname Jerubbaal because he tore down an altar of a false god. So Gideon's name had weight behind it. It was already like, oh snap, Gideon one of them crazy dudes. Now he'll just go out there and knock down altars. That's something else. But then he blew the trumpet before they even fought. Mm.
And you know when he blew the trumpet sounded, and it's amazing the plan of God that he had one company on one side, one on the other side, and one on the other side. Now, here's what normally happens in a war. Once the trumpet is blown, it is to say that the leader is now dead. And we've now won the war.
Right.
by him blowing the trumpet on all sides, makes the people in the middle think they won over here, they won over there, and they won over here. There are no generals left. We are in trouble. And we ain't start fighting yet.
So, don't read it. We're about to see what how they respond. Oh, sorry.
You're fine. Then aside from war, the symbolism kind of makes me think of, like we said, the trumpet is kind of symbolizing victory. And once one person yelled victory, everyone else yelled victory. So that makes me think of how important it is to share our testimonies, because once you tell somebody about your victory, then that gives the people around you the confidence to shout victory before they even get through their trials.
Hallelujah. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
In this specific case, did they make a glory circle on the battlefield?
They did.
I wanted to say
because I realized that it was they set an example from the leadership that all of that were underneath that were with the leadership followed. Mm-hmm. So when one person shouted glory, well, we learned this on revival. Somebody one person shouted glory. Somebody else started shouting, and then somebody else started shouting. And then before they knew it, they were just encompassed in worship.
And this is why here we have what I call the glory circle.
Amen.
Because here's what happens. You bring your troubles to the altar. And when you bring your troubles and concerns, all of your worries to the altar, if everybody around the altar is shouting glory and giving God honor and praising God and worshiping God, every enemy in the middle knows they have lost the battle. And so now they have to flee. And I'm telling you, everything is for a reason. It's for a reason. It's for a reason. Hallelujah.
It's good.
And then is there any symbolism with the number three in there? Because he said separating men into three, and then they flank them in three.
Back to the Trinity all over again. Okay. Normally, whenever you see three, I'm sorry.
Oh, you go.
Normally, whenever you see three, it speaks to Trinity. If not specifically Trinity, which is God the Godhead, but if not that, it speaks to strength. Because a twofold strength is strong, but a threefold strength can hardly even be broken. This is why when you get married, it's not a twofold strength, but it's a threefold strength. God says you're strong if you all tie yourselves together. But if you tie yourself with me, it's hardly broken. It's hard to break.
So I have a question.
Yes, sir.
So this entire time we keep saying that they went to battle without a weapon. Mm-hmm. But then they're saying the Lord of the sword. Or the sword of the Lord. Mm-hmm. So God specifically had them go to battle without physical weapons. Mm-hmm. Because his word is their weapon. His word is enough. So, they just literally just let God fight the battle.
Yeah.
God's word was their sword.
Mm-hmm.
And they fought it in a spiritual sense, not in a physical sense.
Right. And your teacher enlightened me because I've never caught that before.
I was actually thinking about it earlier that they were actually equipped with spiritual armor. So when they fought, they're fighting with spiritual armor. Like it says in Ephesians.
Because never once does it say that they actually have armor on.
Nope.
Yes. Never once.
Never. But the assumption is when you go to war, you already have one. They didn't actually speak to a physical level of armor. But we know they were protected.
I'm going to take a walk.
That protection.
I had a quick question, and I think Hershey might have already answered it, but I was going to ask, what does it look like for us to blow the trumpet on our enemy now? Is that our testimony, like she said, or is it also praise and worship and things and reading the words and things?
I think it's all of the above. I think, so blowing the trumpet upon our enemies is proclaiming that we've already got the victory, because like the word already tells us that. And so it's just a reminder, and it's something for our enemies to hear, like, oh, snap, we don't lose. We don't lose.
So is it just saying that Jesus is Lord and trusting him, believing him?
That's proclaiming victory.
So,
process though to it though. Mm-hmm. There is a process. So before you even get to going through something, you should already be worshiping and praising. Because many of us want to jump to worshiping and praising as a response. But God says if you're already worshiping and praising before the trouble comes, the trouble won't even sway you. She won't even shift you. It won't even move you at all. And then when it comes, you continue to worship and to praise and proclaim victory. And you proclaim victory while you're in the middle of the problem. And so now your worship and praise has destiny and it has purpose, because now you're specifically speaking victory over a specific situation. Mm-hmm. And while you're going through, you continue to speak victory until it manifests from the spiritual into the natural, because the moment you spoke it in the spirit, it already happened already.
Yes.
And so when you continue to speak it, God literally gives you the power that comes from the Holy Ghost to pull what's happening in the spiritual down into the natural. And so you pull your victory down into the natural. And once it manifests, then you go from worshiping and praising and from having victory over an issue into worshiping and praising during your testimony from the issue. And after that, you continue to worship and praise. Notice, worship and praise never stops.
So we should not just
I was just laughing because that same thing that you're talking about happened to us. Monday? So we're in the car and all together we were thinking about renting two cars, but we didn't, we bought one. And I'm in a fit for some reason, because I'm just like ready to go and ready to get to where we're going. So I just start praying. And I'm thanking God. Thank you so much for covering us, oh God. Thank you for your traffic. And then we get this, we get this flat tire, right? And I'm like, oh. But we were already in prayer. We were already thankful for God getting us to where we need to be safely. And when we had the flat tire, we learned to not react the way the enemy would want us to react. You know, we're in unity. Hey, man, this could be all right. He's thinking of what we could do, and I'm trying to bring the peace. Like, all right, sure, let's do that. And immediately, Holy Spirit's like, there's a tire shop right around the corner that we always go to.
Hallelujah.
And we just ride there.
Amen.
And this is my first day of work.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And we get out of that thing about 15 minutes.
Amen.
How many people have a flat tire and it's been 15 minutes from the flat tire to getting to the place to getting back on the road?
I was just asking, so we shouldn't just pray without ceasing. Worship and praise without ceasing.
Amen. Amen. That worship should forever be on our lips.
I think it was also, or the way I'm looking at it, when we look at chapter 6 compared to this, that was also God giving a boost in his confidence. Because I feel like in a way he's questioning God or the right God.
Yeah.
What you see in me, because you chose me out of all these people that you could have chosen. I feel like you boosted him up and hyped with an honest thing.
I feel
the voice is hitting my head right now because it's been a long day, but I feel like that was God giving him that second wind. It was like, you know what, I knew you had it, but go ahead and blow your trumpets and do what you need to do. So I feel like that was also him instilling some confidence and giving in himself.
Amen. Y'all do know that whenever God uses an article or uses a thing in you accomplishing what God has for you to accomplish, God doesn't have to use that thing, right? Everybody realize he don't have to use it. He does it for us. And you're right, he's doing it for us. Because sometimes we need a visual. And God knows what you need, to become confident in what he's saying. And sometimes God will oblige us. And God will, for example, Moses. God called Moses. Moses was afraid because he stuttered, like I stuttered. And he couldn't get his words out. He didn't speak very well. And so God, don't kill him. But keep on saying he couldn't do it. But then God obliged him and said, that's okay. I tell you what, I'll give you an angel. Able to be put.
Yes.
For me, I don't know how he would, but I know for me, my stuttering issue came because I would think ahead of my words.
Yeah.
I'd be thinking ahead of my words, so a lot of times my speaking was behind or at almost synced completely at the same time with my speaking. And so I would be stuttering because I would be on my next sentence while trying to say what I already thought. And I would be kind of confused. And when I understood that, I began to realize, just slow down and get your process your thoughts so that you're able to say what you need to say. It was difficult, though. It was difficult. And I needed God to do it. Some traumatic things happened in my life with those that I love. And I had someone in my life that when I would stutter, would slap me in my face. And it was traumatic. It was terrible. I pray nobody ever has to go through that. And it didn't help me. But my mom helped me. My mom said, listen, this is what I want you to do. Whenever you get ready to speak, I need you to process, complete the thought, then say it. And the more I did it, then my thoughts and my words began to sink better. But that traumatic situation of being hit every time I would stutter actually got me to a place where I could finally calm down. So everything that bad that happens in your life is still for your good. It's terrible. It should never happen. But it's still for your good. You wonder why God allowed you to go through it? Because it's for your good. Ultimately, he says, I'm going to make even what we call bad work out for your good. And for me, work out for my good.
Anybody else?
We're 19, y'all. So Gideon and the 100 men that were with him came unto the outside of the camp at the beginning of the middle watch, and they had but newly set the watch. And they blew the trumpets and brake the pitchers that were in their hands. And the three companies blew the trumpets and brake the pitchers and held the lamps in their left hands and the trumpets in their right hands. To blow without, and they cried, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. And they stood every man in his place around about the camp, and all the host ran, and cried and fled. And the 300 men blew the trumpets, and the Lord set every man's sword against his fellow, even throughout all the hosts. And the host fled to Beth Shittah in Zerath, and to the border of Abel Mohala and Tabith.
Stop it. So we go from Gideon not knowing if he's going to win, even though he was told it, have 22,000 men that's cut down to what? 10. It's cut down to 300. They don't have no weapons. They don't have no nothing. They blow trumpets. And now you got the guys that they were supposed to fight themselves. Oh, wow. It was to the point where they just ran. They started beating themselves up, and they break. Mm-hmm. It's some. Continue on. Oh, I'm sorry, I missed somebody.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
So, they held their trumpets in their right hand and the pitchers in the left hand. The right hand, you know, we lift when we do communion. We hold our right hand in the air. It's like our right hand is authority or power.
Yeah.
So why
earlier how the trumpet signified victory. So, you got something?
Yeah. All I'm going to say is the lamp, I'm thinking of the lampstand of keeping our lamps, our altar on fire, I guess continue praying, and maybe the trumpet is like the victory, like praying on the left, and victory, like proclaiming the victory already. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
And like you said, with the right hand being authority, I saw it as them finally taking and understanding and accepting, oh, you know, we got victory now. Yes, sir.
This past, at the revival, we had realized and we were taught that the glory is always lifted.
Mm-hmm.
Is the lantern supposed, in that moment, supposed not only just a light that's in us, but it's God's glory and they were giving it back to him?
My question then, why would they not hold that in the right hand?
Because the victory was in the right hand. So you were shouting with the sword. So you were using the word of the Lord, and you were proclaiming that the sword of the Lord and of Gideon were already on the way. And they would play the trumpet with their right hand of power, showing that they've already won the victory. So then, if the glory is still needing to be lifted, you only have one other hand.
So, wait, was the lamp lifted?
I realize this, the left hand symbolizes falling into submission.
So, I was just going to say what she said.
Because the right hand is the hand of authority. So, therefore, the opposite of the authority is your left hand, which is falling into submission.
Mm-hmm. So, the right, absolutely, be right, I'm right on point. So, the right hand, I believe it's in Revelation where God says, I hold victory in my right hand. So the right hand speaks to power, and it speaks to victory. The left hand speaks to support. What upgirds you? What do you stand on? It's what's in your left hand. And so what God is saying, the light, the word of God, is in what supports me. It's what I stand on. It's what lifts me up. And victory is in my right hand. Sure, God has a reason for all things. He has a reason for all things. So right-handed people, left-handed people, I have no idea. Has anybody studied about that? I have, I mean, of the biblical significance, I have no idea.
I haven't studied
it. Some people are heavy-handed to one side. Good question. I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer. So doesn't
back in this time most men were right-handed, correct? That's the reason why Ehud was able to kill the king just a few chapters ago. He was able to kill the king with his left hand because there were no customs at that time that looked out or watched anything for left-handed people. So it seemed like the dominance was right-handed males, or what have you. So anytime even today, everything is positioned for right-handed people to be high. Mm-hmm. But whenever you came out left-handed, you were not seen as outward.
It's the same today, too.
Yes. I still hold faith. I don't know the answer.
back onto the conversation with the left-handed being about being for support and submission, mm-hmm. Is that the same reason as to why the way?
Yes.
Because it's to ordain and complete submission to the Lord?
Actually, to your spouse.
To your spouse?
Yes. Because scripture says, submit ye one to another.
And actually, I know we do it backwards sometimes, but usually, whenever the husband and the wife faces the preacher, the wife is supposed to be on the left side, and the
the wife on the right, and then the husband on the right. But here's the thing, though. The husband's family is supposed to be on the left side. Mm-hmm. And the wife's family on the right. Do you know why?
Is it to show the families conjoined?
It's to say, because now your family is mine, and mine is yours. And the flesh now become one. So how many have to do that? But people have lost this moment of, let me pull the word into this moment. And it's just about pretty dresses and, you know, nice games.
Now, is that also, it's not as spoken of how powerful it really is, but is that also in the moment showing that he is going to be leading and being an example as he would be for her family and then his family in the same sense is doing the same part?
When you say the leading example, what do you mean? Right?
So, what I'm meaning is that they both, the husband and the wife, are both going to be separate in their own. They both have their own free will.
Yes.
But at the same time, they both will not necessarily reflect each other, but you will be able to see each other's behavior in each other.
Okay.
So if that's being the same case, it's showing that he is going to be the same type, or he would be an example for his wife's family as his wife would be an example for his family.
Well, I can't say that because I don't know anywhere in scripture that would fully support the mentality. I get the idea, but I don't know any scripture that would fully support that. But what I do know is that each vessel is supposed to reflect God through Jesus the Christ. And if we both are reflecting him, when we become one, we'll never bump heads because we both are reflecting him. And when we become one flesh, it simply becomes a matter of us intertwining to serve God together. Mm-hmm. The problem is, many spouses can't learn how to reason with one another. They can be saying the exact same thing and argue about it. Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of, hey, wait a minute. I've allowed someone to come into my space, and they're going to be on this journey with me. I have to be considerate of someone who is walking with me, and vice versa. Mm-hmm. And now that I'm considerate, the things that I used to do without concern for anybody but me and God, I now have to be concerned how it affects somebody else. Mm-hmm. This is why it is much easier for a single person to be fully committed to God than it is for a married person to be. Because a married person now has to consider God first, but also their spouse. Mm-hmm. Now, if the marriage is truly given over to God, you'll never get in each other's way. All you got to do is tell me, God is telling me to do this. As long as I can't find a scripture to betray what you're saying, I'm going to support you all I can. What are you trying to accomplish? Anything I can do to support it. Go to Ephesians. God says in Ephesians, consider everybody else's thing. In other words, no, I'm not just working through you. So this mentality of, I'm doing what God told me to do, I run over everybody. No. God says, consider the fact that I don't just talk to you, but I talk to other people as well. So when I'm trying to accomplish what God told me to accomplish, I'm going to consider what God told you to accomplish. And I'm going to be considerate and try not to get in your way. And God has fixed it so, if you're considerate, you still can accomplish what he told you to accomplish and be considerate of other believers.
And the men of Israel gathered themselves together out of Naphtali, and out of Asher, and out of all Manasseh, and pursued after the Midianites. And Gideon sent messengers throughout all Mount Ephraim, saying, come down against the Midianites, and take before them the waters of unto Beth, Barah, and Jordan. Then all the men of Ephraim gathered themselves together, and took the waters unto Beth, Barah, and Jordan. They took two princes of the Midianites, Oreb and Zeb, and they slew Oreb upon the rock Horeb. And Zeb, they slew at the winepress of Zeb, and pursued after me, pursued Midian, and brought the heads of Horeb and Zeb to Gideon on the other side of Jordan.
They tried to run. And it says that all the men of Israel gathered together and they chased after them. Whenever they chased them, they caught Oreb and Zeb. Those are the princes of the Midianites. And they slew them. So I wondered, it said they slew Oreb upon the rock, Oreb. And I was like, how you get a rock? What's significant about that? Right? And so through my studies, I found that there was nothing significant about the actual rock before he was slain. That became a landmark, essentially, to say, oh, he was slain on that rock right there. So you don't forget what God did at that place. And then also, Zeb, same thing for the winepress. It became the winepress of Zeb because he was slain there, and it also became another landmark. Shall we continue, or just one? You know, yeah, I'm going to hand it off to you. So let's go on to Judges 8.
And the men of Ephraim said unto him, why hast thou served us thus, that thou callest us not, when thou wentest to fight with the Midianites? They did chide with him sharply.
So when it said that they chided him sharply, they reprimanded all the fellows. They were like, why are you calling us now? Because you're trying to track somebody down. And so, I've learned that over time, what the pastor said before, that back at this time, it was an honor to fight with your brothers. And this group, the men of Ephraim, weren't invited. So they were like, wait a second, yo, like, we couldn't fight with you, but now that you're trying to track somebody down, why are you calling us now? And he said unto them, what have I done now in comparison to you? Is it not gleaning of the grapes of Ephraim? Is not the gleaning of the grapes of Ephraim better than the vintage of Abiezer? So, when he's talking about the gleaning of the grapes, right? Ephraim actually had something, they had double what Abiezer had, right? So, Gideon says to them, y'all always had more than everybody else. Like, what can I do for you that God has already done? God has been looking upon y'all. You know, what do you expect from me? And then read three, can you?
God hath delivered into your hands the princes of Midian, Oreb and Zeb. What was I able to do in comparison of you? Then their anger was abated toward him when he had said that.
So when he said that the anger was abated, they were mad at first, and he was like, well, I mean, God did this for you, and God did this for you too. And they were like, oh, yeah, you're right. I can't even be mad at you no more. Just that simple. Continue.
And Gideon came to Jordan and passed over, he and the 300 men that were with him, faint yet pursuing them. And he said unto the men of Succoth, give, I pray you, loaves of bread unto the people that follow me, for they be faint, and I am pursuing after Zeba and Zalmunna, kings of Midian. And the princes of Succoth said, are the hands of Zeba and Zalmunna now in thy hand, that we should give bread unto thine army?
So what they said to him, he came to them saying, hey, we've been chasing them for a little while now, and my guys, they hungry, they tired, you know, we need something to sustain them. He asked them for bread, and they mocked, saying, oh, you expect us to give you bread as if you already did the job. And so Gideon said, all right, cool. And in verse 7, his response was,
Gideon said, therefore, when the Lord hath delivered Zeba and Zalmunna into my hand, then I will tear your flesh with the thorns of the wilderness and with briars. And he went up thence to Peniel and spake unto them likewise. And the men of Peniel answered him as the man of Succoth had answered him.
Okay. So he said, all right, that's cool. I don't want your bread. I got something for you after we get these guys. Goes to Penuel, or however you pronounce that, and he asked the same thing, and they responded the same way. Did you already catch the guys? So he was like, all right, cool, keep that bet. Continue on.
And he spake also to the men of Peniel, saying, when I come again in peace, I will break down this tower. Now Zeba and Zalmunna were in cardboard, and their hosts with them, about 15,000 men, all that were left of all the hosts of the children of the east. For there fell 120,000 men that drew sword. And Gideon went up by the way of them that dwelt in tents on the east of Nova and Jogbaha, and smote the host, for the host was secure.
Stop there. So, the guys that they tracked there, they thought they were safe. They let their guard down. And as soon as that happened, smoke. Is that what you wrote? Continue. Yes, sir.
So, it's saying that for there fell 120,000 men that drew sword.
Mm-hmm.
Did they literally draw their swords and the word of the Lord just come upon them and they just dropped?
So when it says fail, when I read it, I just thought they just died. They were done. They were killed off. But that's interesting. That's interesting. I don't know.
Because I know God will drop, like, God can immediately take the breath from us at any point in time. So we never know specifically how much time we have. So we have to give glory to God every second of every moment. And in that moment, they knew that they were running away from their battle, from their war. And when they drew their swords against the children of God, in that moment, they dropped.
So Scripture never gives the specifics of this particular battle. Most theologians, and I'm just taking it for the grain of salt, but most theologians assume that Gideon used the same power scheme that he used the last time. In other words, surrounding them both all three sides, blowing the horn, causing a level of chaos and calamity, and their swords killing each other. But God never gives specifics on how they actually knocked off this many people. Also, by the way, how many have seen the movie 300? If you watch 300 in its entirety, it's not totally biblical, but there are a lot of biblical references throughout that particular scripture. One of the greatest references is when he ran into those that would help him fight, and the leader says to them, "We don't need your help, we'll take care of it." And they say, "You don't have many men, this many men, you only have 300. And he asked the man, "Hey, what is your profession?" And the guy said, "I'm a carpenter." He said, "What's your profession?" He said, "I'm a baker." He said, "Well, what is your profession?" He said, "I'm a welder." And then he said, okay. "And what is your profession?" And they all hollered. What did they say? Levi, Sparta. We are warriors. In other words, he says, "Looks like to me I got more warriors than you got." Because he had all them thousands of people and wasn't none of them fighters. Because God had fixed it where Gideon's army was an army. Everybody was a fighter. And they were ready to fight.
Oh, I got to refine the scripture, but I saw earlier that that in the moment that their anger was abated, after they said God had delivered into their hands the princes of Midian or of Ephraim, and what was I able to do in comparison of you? Then their anger was abated toward him when he had said that. And I had the thought that it was giving precedent that the same way that it gives precedent in the Old Testament or the New Testament, that when we're ever angry and we're needing to forgive or being able to move on, just think about what God's done.
Hallelujah.
That's good.
Amen.
Yeah, that's good.
Amen. I do want to say this, though. All through these scriptures, guys, the whole precedent that God is setting for us is to understand, number one, use what you have. And number two, you always got to be ready to fight. And God says, our weapons now are not the swords and the guns, etc. He says, these are our weapons of warfare. It is the word of God. It is prayer. It is faith. He says, you got to be ready to fight. And if you're not operating in faith, if you're not staying in your word, if you're not constantly talking to the Lord, he says you're not ready to fight. And you're going to find yourself in a position where you're going to lose battles over and over again, and you're going to put your faith at risk. Don't let people lie to you and tell you once saved, always saved.
You have to choose God every day. God says, work out your faith, with your salvation with fear and trembling. In other words, exercise your faith. Exercise your salvation. Work it out. Because at the end, you got to still be in him. If at the end you ain't in him, you wasted your time in the beginning.
And when and Gideon went up by the way of them that dwelt in tents on the east of Nobah and Jogbah, and smote the hosts, for the host was secure. And when Zebah and Zalmunna fled, he pursued after them, and took the two kings of Midian, Zebah and Zalmunna, it is comforted all the hosts. And Gideon the son of Joash returned from the battle before the sun was up, and called a young man of the men of Succoth, and inquired of him, and he described unto him the princes of Succoth, and the elders thereof, even 70 men.
Are you still here? So it says that when Zebah and Zalmunna fled, right, he pursued after them, and took the two kings of Midian, Zebah and Zalmunna, and discomfited all the hosts. Discomfited, he essentially just, they were trembling. They were scared, because at this point, they're the only two leaders they have left. So they didn't know what to do. Then it says that Gideon, the son of Joash, returned from the battle before the sun was up, and he caught a young man of the men of Succoth and inquired of him. He asked him, hey, do these two guys look like Zebah and Zalmunna? And he also asked the elders, 77 men. 70, I come to find out that 70 is just 60. So 70 and 17, 77.
Wait. You're telling me not only did he go through a battle the one night, he got hostage the one night?
Two of them. 15.
And he came up to the men of Succoth and said, behold, Zebah and Zalmunna, with whom ye did upbraid me, saying, are the hands of Zebah and Zalmunna now in thine hand, that we should give bread unto thy men that are weary? And he took the elders of the city and thorns of the wilderness and briars, and with them he told the men of Succoth. And he beat down the tower of Penuel and slew the men of the city.
I stop it. So he goes back to the guys that didn't want to give him bread in the first place and says, are these the two dudes that you tried to ridicule me about not having and not catching? And when they confirmed it, he was like, all right. So this was interesting to me. When it said that he took the wilderness and the briars and he taught the men of Succoth, he whooped them. He like gave them a whooping like they were kids. He corrected them. He disciplined them. Then he went to Penuel, the other place that tried to ridicule him, and he did exactly what he said he was going to do. He knocked their tower down.
Now, aren't briars the long, thick thorns? Because if you're telling me that he whooped them with thorns, he wasn't just trying to whoop them. Like, he was tearing his skin off.
He was tearing them up. They are the long, thick thorns.
I'm going to teach you, if you don't mind, let's end. Then, okay, it's all right. Amen. Let's open up for free questions because we're going to baptize. Amen. I said we're going to baptize. Amen. So, are there any other? It's time for free questions, for open questions. Let's thank God for our teacher. Amen. 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 All right. We have about 5 to 10 minutes at the most. For free questions. First of all, any questions about today, tonight's lesson? All right, Ethan.
I don't really know how to ask. So, you know how if a soldier kills, then he's not gonna be like recommended for that by God?
If a soldier kills, he's not
gonna be? Like, if a soldier commits murder.
Right.
It's not looked at the same as if I murdered somebody.
Exactly, actually, not even called murder, yes ma'am.
Okay, mm-hmm. So,
act of war, I'm sorry.
Act of war?
Yes, ma'am.
So, like, Come with me. So, these men that were in war, 300 of them had faith and were men of God.
Right.
And the other ones were iffy, obviously. Most of them died. So, how, like, today, I wonder, like, how it's divided up in a sense of, like, how God uses it. I don't know if anyone kind of gets what I'm trying to say. Maybe I don't get it. But I'm just trying to figure out, like, I feel like there's some type of correlation, like, between...
How that reflects me from that being into that?
Yeah, because this, like you said, it's a prophecy.
Right.
So, the word is alive, so we see war and all these things happen today.
Right.
So I'm sure that there's certain fleets and groups of men that go in, that are soldiers, that may have more faith than others.
Right.
So, like, how does that...
So back in those days, the same way that it is today, you have religious wars, or wars that are mounted by God and driven by God, and then you have wars that are just of men trying to gain more power over other men. There are different kinds of wars. Well, the war today, we're living in the New Testament now. God, we're living in the New Testament, right? We're living in the New Testament now. And in the New Testament now, the war is not a physical battle, it is a spiritual battle. And so every other war is a battle of man. Now, if you are in an army with an actual nation, God allows the responsibility of unrighteous death and the killing during the war lies upon those who are over the war.
Okay, so
the old men that started.
Okay, so I guess that makes more you explain it makes my question form better. So. Oh my gosh. So why, if they're fighting the physical war of power, then why are they not judged for it if they're not fighting the spiritual war?
Here or there?
Here.
Here. Now?
Mm-hmm.
Because they're going under the operation of leadership. So God actually not only speaks about the allegiance or the responsibility of being in complete alliance with Him and Him alone, He also talks about the respect of the nation within which you live. And if you have the level of respect for the nation in which you live, and the nation within which you live, actually, even though we say it, in fact, we don't believe it, but in fact, we say, one nation under God. So if we are in an army in this nation, then the assumption is the war that we go in is some level of a righteous war. Is it always? Most of the time, it is not. But the responsibility rests upon those who choose to send us into war. Not on the soldier.
Okay.
Not on the soldier at all. Now, for their unrighteousness and why they went in, God will hold those accountable that sent them into war. Okay? All right. Good question. Very good question.
I'm sorry.
Yes, ma'am.
They wouldn't be held accountable even though they're doing the actions?
No. Not for war. Not for war. In fact, let's go deeper though. Now, if during the war the person goes outside of the instruction of the actual people that rule the war, then now you're not acting under the leadership, you're acting on your own accord. For example, going somewhere and killing kids, or going somewhere and taking the women and raping them. None of that was the directive of the actual war, you did it on your own. And you held fully accountable for that. Ask a question. I see it in your head. Come on.
I think I understand what maybe it's my interpretation of my question. Back then, God said, hey, go ahead and clear them out because they want some smoke.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, it's like, he ain't really got nothing to do with us. Into Russia and stuff like that, so how would they not be deemed as...
But the assumption is, when you join the military, I've been armed myself, briefly. My brother retired from the military. And so when you join the army, the assumption is that you are joining an army that has a desire to protect either the physical or the influence of freedom in the U.S.
Okay.
That's the assumption of every soldier. I'm fighting for my nation to keep my people free.
And the major
Yes.
What about voting, though? Because if we're voting under what the leader says, we're still judged for that. Because I remember,
absolutely.
I remember you speaking about it. Like, you're not going to put your name on something that you don't know where it's really going or what the intent of it is behind the shirt.
Absolutely not. Because one day, you're right. One day, I've got to account for that. So you know when you vote, you put your name on that person's name. Wait a minute, man. Everybody understand this, right? Understands that, right? When you go and vote, you're putting your name on somebody. You're saying, I feel confident in my spirit that this person is going to do what God agrees with. Nothing to do with the nation, nothing to do with nothing else. I'm voting because I feel like this person is not going to do anything that is against the word, the will, or the way of God. That's what you're doing. I'm not making it up. That's the word. That's what you do when you vote. Watch this. You cannot. Now, if the person betrays that, that's different. But if you have not discerned that to begin with, and I don't want to hear this stuff about, well, I think he's the lesser of two evils and all that. No. No. Have you discerned that this person has a desire to do what God agrees with? And in that situation, you can definitely put your name on it. And if they may betray you, but God will deal with what you discern. What was in your spirit, what was in your heart. That's what God will judge, that's what God will actually deal with. And that's what you actually vote upon. For me, I'm not going to put my name on anybody that God has not revealed to me will be for the good of the kingdom. And I ain't want no black folk, no white folk, no whatever folks, or Asian, or Puerto Rican, Latin, whatever. I can give a care less. Are they going to do what's good for the kingdom of God? That's what I want to know. And if you are in my spirit, you got my vote. That's how I vote. Because that's how God tells us to respond. So, obviously, because of what happened in this nation, it's difficult to get to a presidential level without being dirty. And if you don't understand that, you have lost your mind. It's difficult to get that high up into politics and not have some dirt on you somewhere. Mm-hmm. On the lower level, normally these are people that we probably have seen or talked to at some point in our communities. And whether you know it or not, that's the only levels where your vote really counts anyway. And I don't even want to get into that. Just being real. Just being real. If you start getting into electoral colleges and all that kind of stuff, you'll realize your vote doesn't really matter that much anymore. On that level, though. But on community level, which is where it really counts, now that's where your vote actually counts. And you're able to touch these people, talk to them, ask them questions, and hold them accountable for their answers. And that's not political. I'm talking about kingdom. About kingdom. All right, any other questions? All right, we got 5 minutes. All we have is 5 minutes, guys, for free questions, questions outside of what's in the word and what we talk about today, tonight. But it's time for open questions, open forum. We got about 5 minutes. Anybody got anything tonight? Yes, sir?
So, earlier you were talking about once saved, always saved.
Yes, sir.
And to, like, constantly be in the word.
Absolutely.
And so, in Romans 6, how it talks about shall we continue to sin that grace may be abound? Certainly not. How should we die to sin then any longer? So if we have grace and we're just living through life, you know, like we're a flesh, so we're gonna continue to sin.
Are we?
Not purposefully. But
how from your assumption, I just want to get clarity. So your assumption is because we are in flesh that we're never stop sinning.
Well, there's just things I guess I feel like.
I ain't trying to mess you up. I just want you to think about what you just said.
Yes.
Right, but go ahead.
I guess what I'm trying to ask is, like, we have grace, but how do we continue to live, like, you know, how we're supposed to have, like, hold the word to our hearts, how do we continue to live, like, in God's will for our life, our path for our life, and live in grace, and, like, we're going to mess up, but we're going to continue to make mistakes, but then still have grace to be, like, continue to be saved, I guess.
Mm.
I don't know if my question makes sense.
Right. So I don't want to connect continuing to be saved with making a mistake or making a foolish decision. I don't want to connect those two together. Let me tell you why. Because scripture says, he who sinned, ETH, which means continues to sin. There's where your danger of hellfire comes. So if you sin and you stay in sin, now God says, if you sin, there is forgiveness. S-I-N, sin. Not S-I-N-N-E-T-H. So if I sin, God says, I have the right to come to God because I'm now saved and ask for forgiveness.
Yes.
And he said he'll be faithful and just to forgive me of all unrighteousness, but he doesn't stop there. He said he'll cleanse me mm-hmm. of all unrighteousness,
right.
Which means I'll forgive you for what you did, and I'll wash the stain away, and I will wash the dirt that you picked up along the way. I'll wash it off of you. We have a responsibility to not become pigs, which means a pig will get out of the slop, out of the dirt, out of the mud. Its owner will wash him off, spray him off, get him clean, and he'll go right back to the mud. We have a responsibility to not become swine and go back to the mud and the dirt again. So this is what God says in Scripture. He says, he who is my son does not sin. In other words, as you become submitted to the Holy Ghost, you should sin less. And less, and less, and less, and less, until you get to the place where you've gone beyond having to avoid sinning, and now you're having to focus on the sin of omission. In other words, making sure that I'm not missing God's direction to do certain things because I didn't hear what he said. I'm beyond that the sin of adultery and fornication. I finally got past that. I ain't even worried about that no more. I'm focused on hearing God and obeying what he said about my life right now and how I affect other people. We got to continue to mature and grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. How do you get to that place? That is by submitting to God by the power of his Holy Ghost through his son Jesus. So what does that look like? That means staying in your word. That means staying on your knees. That means continually listening for the voice of God and continually submitting to his Holy Ghost. How do I know what he's saying if I never look at what he wrote? So if I constantly see what he wrote, I now know what he sounds like. And so now when the voices come, I'm able to distinguish which voice is his and which voice is not. If I'm listening to his voice constantly, then you'll start seeing me get to a place where we, what scripture says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye by the of your mind. In other words, I've got to get to a place. Okay, so watch this. We're ready to go. And this is for you too, Kim. When you first give your life to Christ, God says, when you go down in the water, come out of the water, he says that your body is washed clean, he said, but the old man is dead. Literally, God says, he killed the old man. So why in the world, if my old man is dead, why do I keep going back to sin? The reason we go back to sin is because our mind is not transformed. Because even though the old man is dead, the old mind still exists. And so when things happen, your mind tends to respond in its old familiar way of responding to things.
Yeah.
The old man is dead, but the mind doesn't know how to act now.
Yeah.
How do I respond to things now? How do I respond to that? He cuts me out. What do I do now? He cut me off on the road. What do I do now? The old man is dead. How do I respond? Well, the mind says the old man is dead, but I remember what the old man used to do. And so now, I'm throwing finger signs and cutting people out on the side of the road. He cuts me out, I'm ready to fire, and all this and all that. because you're responding the way you are familiar with responding. This is why God says the old man is dead, but you've got to renew the mind. And when you renew your mind, you begin to teach yourself by the power of the Holy Ghost how to start responding in the new man's way of responding. Now watch this. When you begin to respond in this new way of doing things, it's going to feel awkward. It is going to feel unnatural. You're going to feel like a punk, man.
Yeah.
You're going to feel like, man, I'm not feeling, let this dude, wait a minute, man. I can only go so far. I feel a grown man. It's going to feel off. But you keep on doing it, and you keep on doing it until you train yourself. This is how I respond. This is intelligent. And before you know it, your eyes will open up and you'll realize, no, I'm not a punk. Actually, I'm stronger than you are. And because I have exercised temperance, I actually save you. That make sense? Cool, baby. Here. Yes, baby. Conversation about what sin is, because two things have to happen. In Scripture, God identifies sin. He actually had a list of those things. The same way God has a list of fruits of the Spirit, He also has a list of those things which God abhors, which He hates, which He is disgusted by. And if somebody finds that Scripture, let's give it, let's say it out loud. Galatians 5.
I think it's also in like James.
Also in what now?
In James, when he defined what sin is.
In James. I'm looking for the lust of the flesh. Galatians 5.
I think it's James 4.
I think 5 and 18. Somebody would read that real quickly. Whoever has it, please.
Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like.
Yes.
Of which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Watch this. Now watch this. He just read the lust of the flesh. Look over to my left, your right. Those are the commandments. And the way the violation of those commandments manifest is in the lust of the flesh. You see what I'm saying? This is why the commandments are behind us or over our head. They actually guide us. They're the guiding light for our mentality to help us stay focused. This is what woos us and what draws us. The cross and the cross alone. But once we've been wooed and drawn to the cross, over us at all times is what he said. Does that make sense? And so this is what we follow. And that's the way you identify that which is a sin. Amen? Amen. And by the way, God shows us, you know that you cannot know the word, not know exactly what God said in the word, but God, because he said, if I put my Holy Spirit inside of you, there's something on the inside that shakes you up when you know you ain't doing what's right. You may not know what scripture it is, where is that in the word, but on the inside, something troubles your spirit when you're getting ready to do it. You knew you was wrong before you did it. You knew it. Before you put your hands on it, you knew you was wrong. I told you the other day, many people talk about, I'm trying to not be tempted, and I don't want to go through all that. But before you left home, you grabbed a condom and put it in your pocket. Bro, you knew what you was doing before you did it. It's in your spirit. God said, he's inside of you. And he's telling you when you out of order. We know it. Yes, ma'am.
Someone who is truly submitted to the Holy Spirit is not going to keep going back to the same sin and the same sin So that's one. And then to get on Galatians 5, I have a little group that we were studying, and we were actually looking up the context of the words. And I know, like, a lot of young people like us who like to go and party, you know, I'm going to be going to the bar, you know, I'm going to be going to the club. So that word revelings actually means drinking parties that extend late into the night with loud music that actually end in sexual debauchery. So partying is in the Bible, being up in the club, being drunk, all that's in there too. That's it.
By the way, the issue is not the party, the issue is the intent. And the intent of that party is for people to end up in that situation. Mm-hmm. And by you going and being involved in that atmosphere, oftentimes you put yourself in a position to be caught up in what you never intended to do. Mm-hmm. And you got to guard your heart with all diligence. Mm-hmm. And that atmosphere is a dangerous atmosphere. It's a dangerous atmosphere. That's why I'm going to hear Kent. Kent, you hear it? Earl, you good?
Oh, mm-hmm. It was for the sin.
Okay. Are you found?
James?
I just had a different version.
Oh, okay.
Proverbs 6 and 16.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
These 6 things doth the Lord hate. Yea, 7 are an abomination unto him. Mm-hmm. A proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, and heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift and running to mischief. A false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among brethren.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Y'all, you know, everything that you read, if you don't violate those commandments, you'll never do. You'll never do. Yes, ma'am. We hear here, then we hear there. Yes, sir.
So, if I'm in a situation where somebody is testing me,
they're
putting me in the position to like test my anger or they want to take advantage of me. What do I do to stay a believer in Christ and not call myself a sin while they still are actively trying to take advantage of me? They're showing me that they don't care about me. They're trying to cause harm to me. What do we do in that situation to protect ourselves and stay in the grace of God?
Because he's talking about their situation, and I'm trying to be a God-fearing. I am a God-fearing one.
Yes, ma'am, you are.
And I'm like, I want to move this way, but I need to protect myself from, you know, evil. Right. And I'm praying, and we're praying, and we're trying to move in this particular direction, but the enemy is like, bah, bah, bah. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, he's, you know, leading, like trying to encourage me to, you know, protect myself, protect us from the situation, and then I'm like, well, I feel like that's too much protection. Like, I don't want to sin while trying to, like, we're trying to figure out how to fight this with God and not hurting the other situation.
Okay, so not a lot of answers in there, but let me kind of start here. Most fights start with preparation. Uh-huh. Sometimes we're trying to fight a fight when we should never have been in the situation to begin with. And so what God is saying is, guard your heart with all diligence. If you know this is an area of foolishness and an area that you have to be in, why are you in the area? That's the first thing we should ask ourselves. Why are we even here to begin with? Also, if this relationship is a toxic relationship, one that is not given to God, and there's no desire by both parties to be submitted to God, why are you continuing the relationship? Another question. And so these preparation moments will help us, first of all, not be in a situation that would cause us to have to be careful about not violating our ambassadorship for God the Father through Jesus the Christ. That's number one. Number two, if we should still so find ourselves in a situation where that happens, somebody is challenging us on that level, for example, at work. You can't avoid it at work. This is my job. You know, unless I do that job. So if that happens at work or in a situation where I had to be there and it comes to me, then in that situation, you must exercise temperance.
Okay.
You exercise long suffering. If that's, you should have a heart to try to walk away. Do all that you can. And if you must defend yourself, do so in a manner of godly wisdom. I ain't trying to kill you. I ain't trying to put you out. I'm going to get you off me. But I ain't trying to hurt nobody. Like number one. So you want to exercise godly wisdom. Now watch this. God says in everything, when it comes to sin, he gives us a way of escape.
He does.
And if you are keen and you're listening to the voice of God in every situation where sin would be tempting, there was a moment when you could have got away. And so our responsibility is to constantly be listening to the voice of God where we can see a thing coming from a mile away.
Is that praying and watching?
You feel me?
Mm-hmm.
Like literally, you should be in a position where I'm walking, me and Carol walking to go somewhere or whatever, and we headed in, and one of us may say, Carol may say, baby, I don't feel like we can go in here. Even if I don't feel it. But you say, well, baby, is that what God is giving you for real? I feel like God is telling me we not go in here. Guess what we doing? We're going to the house. Because that may have been our way of escape. You see what I'm saying? So we got to be listening to God at all times. This is why we're watching and praying. Because a lot of stuff, God has already pulled you out before you even went in. But because we ignored his voice, we went in anyway. And now we find ourselves trying to figure out how to get out of it. And it's hard. It's hard. It's real hard. Amen.
Oh, I just had a scripture about sin, but we kind of passed that topic.
You good?
Uh-huh.
Okay, yes, sir.
I was going to give you a scripture that helps me all the time when I'm in that same type of situation. It's James 1:2-3. Count it all joy when you fall in when you face diverse temptations.
Yeah.
And in that moment, you're going to be having to when you're in the faith, you're going to be tried constantly, whether it be your flesh, somebody else coming up trying to rise the flesh out of you, or just your own thoughts and your wicked heart. Your heart is just wicked. But then it also goes to saying to your faith is going to try patience and let patience have her perfect work. So you just have to trust that God's going to keep you and let him have patience over you. And we had a sermon from Pastor Brandon a couple of weeks ago. The Holy Spirit will sit on you if you ask him to. And when he sits on you, nothing will shake you.
Hallelujah. Amen. Go ahead, Casey.
So
it's
kind of
off the topic.
So let's say I'm at home with my family, or it's at nighttime, and a group of robbers
If I have a gun, they're going to die.
It's okay.
Y'all, it's going to sound bad, but I'm dead serious. I'm pretty serious.
Okay.
I'm not that at all.
So that's okay.
They're going to die. But because, number one, my family is in jeopardy. And it ain't even about me. It's that my wife sleeps. And even though she is my wife or ride, she'll fight for herself. But I ain't going to let the house do that. They're going to die. And my daughter is there. And she's a heavy sleeper. They're going to die. Simple as that.
Yeah.
So if I have a gun, they'll die that way. If I have a bat, they'll die that way. How, whatever I get to, they're going to die.
Absolutely.
You can defend your house. God gives you the right to do that. And guess what? You ain't going to hell for it. You ain't going to hell for it.
I just pray that you don't test me.
I'm not going to let you test me here.
Don't test.
I'm going to defend my house with everything I have. If anybody going to die, I'm going to die first. I'm going to have to be dead. So whatever. Absolutely. Absolutely. If anything happens, I'm going to die first. And then that's the only way you're getting to my family. Is if I'm dead. Now watch this. If by chance I have to do that, God knows what I had to do. I'm not trying to kill them just because I'm mad they came to my house. I don't know if I let you live what you're going to try to do. So I'm going to put you down and make sure you're down for good. And be as simple as that.
We're not giving you no presents from that.
So you're right to take care of your house, absolutely. Yes, sir. Okay, I've been wrong.
Oh, in Exodus 22, it kind of hits on that. It says, if a beast be found breaking up and be smitten, that he died, there shall no blood be shed for him.
So it's kind of, yeah, so we read what we want that.
If a beast be found breaking up and be smitten, that he died, there shall no blood be shed for him.
Amen, amen. And that is the scripture, absolutely. In other words, remember, it was blood for blood. So back in those days, especially explicitly, if you were to commit murder, then you would be killed. But scripture basically says, if a robber comes into your house or come up on you or tries to rob you and you end up killing them, that you would not be punished for that.
And it does apply in clothing as well, right?
Absolutely. 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 If you're in danger, God gives you the right to defend yourself. I'm coming to you. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. It's never okay to kill, but
no,
God
carries.
God never says anything about you not be happy able to carry. There's no scripture there. In fact, God said there's a time for all things. You know? And then God even talks about there's a time to carry us forward. So if you carry, now watch this, it's according to your faith. If I have the faith to not carry a gun and believe that God will keep me, thank God for my faith. If you believe that if you carry a gun, that you have the faith that God will give you the understanding of when to use it and how to use it, that's where your faith is. But I need to know what your relationship requires. Are you saved? That's what I'm here for. Are you saved? I can give a care less if you got a gun. So I need to know you got a house, a home to go to when you leave here. Right? Any other questions? Are we getting ready to? You can go ahead and get ready to play. All questions clear? Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you. Come on, stand to your feet. Father God, we thank you so much for what you have done tonight, for the understanding that you have garnished and given to us, for the enlightenment, for the power of your Holy Spirit. Thank you, God, for the wisdom that you gave this teacher tonight, for guiding and directing him, giving insight into your word. Thank you for the soberness of his mind, being able to bless this your people. Thank you, God, for this house. Now, God, as we transition, we thank you for this blessed opportunity that we might be able to be witnesses to one who has given his life to you. As we see him go in the water, then come out of the water, we pray that your Holy Spirit would rest so heavily deep inside him that there be an overwhelming eruption within his spirit. Have your way, God. Show yourself mighty tonight. So we give you glory, we give you honor. We bless your wonderful name. So have your way, God. For those who are not able to stay, I pray traveling grace and mercy over them. I pray that they would move in a manner that would show how they honor and respect the sacredness of this moment, that it be not a distraction. But I pray that those who understand the importance of the moment would stay and celebrate with this young James. As the angels rejoice, we shall rejoice with them. We love you, God. We glorify you, and we thank you. Have your way. In the name of Jesus. If you will, if you're able to, we're going to gather around the water. Hallelujah. Okay. Oh.
It's hard some days to love myself. Couldn't find the words for what I felt. I was depressed, wounded, helpless, oh, but then you called me by name. That could be called a game of living water. You covered me with love. Your silence, no shame. You kept me arms wide open.
Up again, everything will be new.
Thank you.
Truly, he shall be a new creature.
Yes.
Have your way, God.
Have your way.
In the name of Jesus, and the people of God said, amen.
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 And amen.
You waited so patiently.
God, I thank you that you've already blessed him to speak with his mouth, that he accepts you as his Lord. He's already said he believes in his heart that you raised up his son, your son Jesus, from the dead. And so by the power vested in me, by the great head of the church, Jesus the Christ, I will baptize you, my brother, in the name of Jesus. And you will go down in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. Really quickly, and he'll come back out and we'll have communion with him for the very first time as our brother in Christ. Come on, tell God thank you.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. 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 Bless his wonderful name. Hallelujah. Bless his wonderful name. Hallelujah, God. Come on, right where you are, let's pray right where you are. Father God, we thank you so much for allowing us to witness what we just witnessed. We thank you, God, and we rejoice with the heavens. And now, God, as he prepares to come out and receive Holy Communion for the first time after baptism, we pray, God, that we, his brothers and sisters, will be proper encouragement for him. And that we might be good examples before him. Help us to live a life that he can look at and say, I see that. I can do better. I thank God for what God showed me. I saw big sister move and I learned better how to move. I saw big brother move and I learned better how to live. Father God, help us to be what we need to be before him. So that he might be stronger in you. And bless him, God, to live out the fullness of his destiny. That which you have called him to be. I pray that he doesn't lose it. Yes. Keep him safe, God. And I pray that when he dies an empty vessel.
Yes.
That you have filled and he has poured out amongst your people. I pray he don't die with gifts and die with overflow. But that he dies one who poured out everything he had until it was time to go.
Yes, thank you.
Have your way in him, God. And I pray for his family, that his family will be an encouragement to him. Empower them, God. Give them what to say, how to say it, and when to say it. And bless them that they might grow in you, that he might see them growing and be all the stronger.
Yes, thank you, God.
Father God, bless their lives to be so full of your Holy Spirit that things that they never knew they could overcome have been overcome already. Have your way, God. We trust you. We believe you. And we thank you. In the name of Jesus. Now, God, we pray over this Holy Communion.
Yes, thank you, God.
Thank you, God, for your life.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God, for your blood. And we'll never forget what you did for us. Have your way, God. Now, prepare this, your people, to receive this communion. If any man be here, not worthy to receive, they either would sit down at the moment or that they might consecrate now and prepare. Have your way, God. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Listen to me. 1 Corinthians says that if you take the Holy Communion unworthily, he said that's the reason a lot of sickness is in the land right now. Because many have received this Holy Communion and they weren't worthy. Now, know in your own regard, we'd never be worthy. But if we're saved, we're covered by the blood of Jesus. And because we're covered by the blood, his blood makes us worthy. And he said, if you haven't been covered by the blood, if you haven't given your life to Christ, you ain't ready for this moment. So prepare yourself. Finally, God talks about forgiving your brother. If you have an ounce against your brother, you have this moment to get it right in your heart. Forgive them. Let it go. Don't let that thing linger in your spirit. Release it now in the name of Jesus. Prepare yourself to receive the Holy Communion. We'll play a little music, about 35, 40 seconds, a little bit, maybe a little longer. Just give you a chance to consecrate yourself, to prepare yourself. Listen to me. Scripture says, if you hungry, eat at home. This is not an eating moment. This is a remembrance of what our Savior did for us on the cross.
Yes.
So you gotta be. Get yourself consecrated, prepared to receive the body and the blood. Hallelujah.
He shared with me
Somebody bless them in the room. Somebody bless them. Come on, somebody bless them in the room. Come on, somebody bless them in the room. Oh, you can do better than that. Somebody bless them in the room. Glory! Glory! Bless his wonderful name. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. And I know it was the blood. And I know it was. He stood up and he girded himself, which means he put on an apron. And when he put on an apron, he began to serve those who were made to serve him, which is why me, your humble servant, serve you today. Scripture says that my Savior, my Lord, he who is over all, stood up and he took bread and he broke it and he blessed it. You would carefully remove the upper lid of your cup and remove the bread. Hold it in your right hand, slightly, a little bit higher, lifting up the glory. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. Scripture says he blessed it. Father God, we thank you so much for your body that you allowed to be beaten and tortured and bruised, that my iniquities be put away from me. You fixed it so that disease wouldn't have power over me ever again. You healed my sin-sick soul.
Thank you, Jesus.
And you allowed your body to be beaten on my behalf. And we will never forget what you did for us, even in the flesh. And so at this moment, God, we bless this bread as a moment of remembrance that we would never forget. Let us receive the bread together. Hallelujah. Bless his wonderful name. Very carefully, if you would remove the second layer, the second lid, you've heard me say before that it is perfectly suited that our cup would have two lids. For if you know in the tabernacle, the first veil, when you enter into the sanctuary, is the first lid, which goes through the flesh of our Lord and Savior. But it is the second lid that places our sin into remission, that which gives us access to the blood. And Scripture said he took the wine and he blessed it. Father God, we thank you so much.
Thank you, Jesus.
For your blood that was shed on our behalf. For we know it was the blood that saved us. For because of your blood, our sin was pressed and forced into remission. That though it had power over us, it shall and does not have power over us ever again.
Yeah.
And that let every man be a liar and let you be the truth. Yeah. For you have said that we don't have to sin ever again. That this flesh no longer has to have power over us if we would just submit to you.
Yeah.
So we thank you for the blood. And so God, we now bless this wine. That it might represent your blood. That we would never forget the blood that was shed for us. And that same blood that was placed on the mercy seat as a debt counselor for every issue that we created. We love you, we glorify you, and we thank you. In the name of Jesus, let us receive the wine together. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Bless his wonderful name. Hallelujah.
Thank you for your blessing.
Bless his wonderful name. And I know it was the blood. And I know it was the blood. And I know. and he died upon the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. Grab somebody's hand right where you are. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Bless his wonderful name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Before you leave, I need at least three or four of the men to come and to make sure you get Kenny's phone number before you leave.
Ken.
I keep calling him Kenny.
He don't like it. Why are you telling me?
Ken, amen.
Amen.
That helps actually because we have a Kenny.
We got a Kenny.
So that gives a Ken and a Ken be all right now.
All right.
It's a good thing. Amen. But I need you all to get Ken's number before you leave so you can make sure that he has a good support system. Scripture talks about that seed that was placed on the ground. And there were places where it was placed too high, wasn't deep enough, and the rain just kind of washed it away. And it was one where it was planted, but the thorns and the thickets pulled the seed and snatched it out of the ground. But then it's that place where you plant the seed, which is what is in Ken right now, and it's deep enough, and it has to manifest a harvest that will go on for the rest of his life. But in order for that thing to grow properly, he needs some support. So I need your men to come by, say hello, get to know him, create a network of believers. His DNA has changed, and he needs to know he's never by himself. Even if everybody turned their back on him, he ain't by himself. And this walk will be the best thing that ever happened to him. So we need you, men. We need you. Come on, let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we glorify you and we thank you. We thank you for what you did tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you for saving Ken's life.
Yes, God.
Thank you for saving our life.
Bless your
and we will never forget what you did.
Thank
and
you,
so now, God, we see your kingdom continuing
yes,
to expand. And we pray that we do what we're supposed to do.
Yes, God.
To secure and protect what belongs to you. Help us to be good ambassadors.
Help us, God.
And help us be responsible, brothers and sisters, that our sibling would not fall.
Yes.
Help us to live a life that gives you glory in every way. I want to see them all when we get to heaven.
Yes.
I pray, God, that you would make us whole in every way. We thank you for what you have done. We'll never forget your sacrifice for us. So we give you glory. We give you honor. And we will never forget what you did. So have your way in our lives. Travel in grace and mercy over every soul in this circle. And they'll make it home safe and secure. And that there may be peace when they arrive. Have your way, God. In fact, let the ride home be the most serene that it ever had been before.
Yes, thank
let them feel the wind a different way. Let them feel the comfort a different way. Just put your hands on them, God.
Yes, put your hands on them.
In the name of Jesus. We trust you. We believe you. And hallelujah, we thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you. And we thank you. Thank you. And we thank you. Thank you, and we thank you.
Thank you.
Bless your wonderful name.
Bless your wonderful
people
name.
Of God say amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Come on, love on this man of God before you leave. God bless you, every one of you.
Thank you.